Are you concerned with this heavy dependence on property taxes for city revenue, and do you have any plans of pursuing other income streams? Joe Penfield.
I'm extremely concerned. If you're in New York, Chicago, because we also compare ourselves to those cities, the property tax portion is not 28 to 39%, it's about half of that. Because there they have access to wealth generated taxes, like income taxes and sales taxes. And frankly, Ontario is the only jurisdiction in Canada where such an over reliance on the property taxes on sales purposes. And that's simply wrong. In my opinion, the solution is not to find new taxes. Simply make sure that the taxes which presently get raised, you know, remember 92% of those go to the federal police department, get proper given to Toronto, which is Canada's biggest city, the provincial capital of Toronto. They should be proud, there should be serious investment here, and there isn't. We have to go begging for investment to those who are collecting our taxes, and that's simply wrong and needs to be changed. That's what the Canadian Spartan said, that's what Montreal is saying, that's what Vancouver is saying, that cities have to be treated with respect. No one simply as beggars, you know, for services that all of us need.
George Fisman.
Well, this is really, I think, for all of you in this room, the defining point of distinction between me and Councillor Pantalone. Because everybody associated with the organization perhaps wants me to say that I support the idea that Toronto should implement a new sales tax, as an example, to further diversify the stream of revenue and to have less dependence on property taxes. But I really think that what I owe you is the honest answer that comes from experience, which means a recognition of the times that we are in and also the trend line that we were on. What I know is that since Mayor Miller came to office, the City of Toronto has gained a share of the federal gas tax, the provincial gas tax, has had uploading in the areas of public health, land ambulance, and social services, with planned uploading to continue for the next 4 or 5, I think maybe even 6 years. In addition to that, the City of Toronto Act was passed, which has given the City of Toronto the land transfer tax, a $52 million vehicle registration tax, and more recently, an advertising tax. In addition to that, this government has introduced a fee for service associated with waste, and most years, the rate of increase in taxes was at or slightly above the rate of inflation. In the times that we're in, I don't think it's realistic to assume that on top of those things, we're going to have the bounty of an additional stream of revenue. As a progressive person, I'm dedicated to finding a way within the existing resource base to still show a path forward for progress. And I think that is the challenge of the times that we are in, where the federal and provincial levels of deficit are extremely troubling and unlikely to produce the rewards that we might wish in the very short term.
Rocco Rossi.
The reality is we have a lower reliance on property taxes, a percentage of overall revenues than Montreal, Ottawa, and Vancouver. But Joe is right, it's higher than New York or Chicago, but not by double. New York is in the mid to high 20s. Nonetheless, we do ourselves a disservice with the province and with the federal government by not showing real discipline with our own spending. And one of the problems is that the latest survey indicates that only 12% of Torontonians believe that City Hall spends its money wisely. And the only good news about that is that that's 9% more than believe Elvis still lives. But it is an incredibly low level of legitimacy that allows Queen's Park and Ottawa, quite frankly, to not be the fulsome partners that they could be if we were in a stronger negotiating position. And part of that means that we need multi-year planning. A $9.2 billion operating budget planned 1 year at a time is not a recipe for negotiating strength with upper levels of government. I mean, imagine going into your banker and asking for $9.2 billion and saying, here's my 1 year business plan. That conversation is not going to last very long.
Very interesting and very important topics. Just to go back and forth a little bit, would all of you agree that the multi-year budgeting process might be, Joe?
Well, I think there's a false impression being given here. First of all, we do have a 10-year capital plan in this city, so therefore it's not a year by year. And don't worry, you know what? You have 5,000 police officers. You think you're going to start from scratch next year and have no police officers? You know, obviously there's the base is what it is, and you build it from there. In effect, there is a multi-year planning because you're committed to maintaining what you presently have.
All right, so multi-year.
So therefore, I think it's just giving a false illusion there to the reality.
But firstly, an approach to multi-year budgeting, and many of you know who are running organizations, means you're looking as far down the pipeline as you can for the opportunities, like when a contract comes due, maybe to renegotiate it at a different level, or for other forms of opportunities, say, to, with respect to new granting opportunities or what have you. It's about actually lifting your head up, to use the analogy of hockey, not coming across the blue line, carrying the puck with your head down, which very often results in a bad circumstance. The thing about it is that the City of Toronto projects a sense of powerlessness, which is unhelpful to us overall. And I am personally tired of the situation that occurs every year where my city projects that it is broke and bankrupt and powerless. I reject this, and I think we have to take back a sense of power and responsibility for the budget.
Now, we are getting into some really interesting stuff. I want to give the last word to Bronco on this. This is an interesting and important. Yep.
From 2002 to 2008, labor costs at the City of Toronto grew by 6.5% a year, each year compounded. That's three times GDP growth. It's three times higher than the rate of the average income of the average taxpayer in this city. Unless we confront that issue, realistically, as adults, we're not going to be able to control this budget. And that requires numbers you can count on. You can't show up at the end of the year, hold a really important press conference, only to announce that, guess what, good news everyone, I just found $100 million under a sofa cushion somewhere. It totally undermines our credibility with senior orders of government. If you're the province, what are you thinking in that conversation when you're seeing the mayor say that?